Welcome to the Blue Ridge Baptist Church YouTube channel. It's brought to you by the folks here at Blue Ridge Baptist Church, and we pray you receive a special blessing while spending the time here with us. And to God be the glory. We are glad to announce that the Blue Ridge Baptist Church Jubilee will begin September the 19th and continue through September the 22nd. We will begin each evening at 7 p.m. So come and join with us as we lift up the name of Jesus in song and gain instruction and wisdom from the preaching of God's Word during these days of Jubilee. Those dates once again are September the 19th through the 22nd at 7 p.m. here at Blue Ridge Baptist Church, located 150 East 11th Street in Buena Vista, Virginia.
Losing the race. losing the race, were it not for grace.
Thank you, Jesus.
I'm thankful for the good grace of God this evening, aren't you? I bless the Lord for it, huh? I sure do. You know, Brother Eugene Hatcher. Now, you don't know Brother Eugene Hatcher, but when God saved Brother Eugene, called him to preach, he preached like a dynamite. I mean, he just exploded when he preached. And he preached for an hour, hour and 15, 20 minutes. And I mean, time he got through, every stitch of his clothing was wet. The first pew and the second pew was wet, and he just preached, and his heart cried out, you know, for sinners. He was an evangelist, and blessed, wonderful. And I cherish the memory of those old camp meeting days and old tent meeting days when we were together. But old Brother Eugene and I were out in Louisiana listening to, we was at a camp meeting together in this morning service, and there's a brother got up to preach, and he kept telling us he was fixing to really preach. And man, we sat there and sat there and sat there, and he never did get nothing done. I mean, it was pitiful. And Eugene looked over at me, and he said, Brother Ralph, he said, you know, there's somebody, if somebody can preach, it makes me want to preach. But if somebody can't preach, it really makes me want to preach, you know. He was chomping at the bits. Well, I'm kind of like that about preaching, kind of like that about singing. Somebody that can sing makes me want to sing, you know. And then somebody that can't sing makes me really want to sing. Praise God. Can y'all mind if I sing this song? I'm going to sing this song. It's all right. Y'all got the cream already, so y'all gonna get a little bit of the cull now. I had this song on my heart, and I wanted to sing it. And I get kind of prideful singing. We got so many singers around here and everything, but hallelujah! You gotta have somebody dragging the tail end up, you know. Some of you can relate to this.
Life is easy when you're up on the mountain and you've got peace of mind like you've never known. But when things change and you're down in the valley, don't lose faith, 'cause you're never alone. For the God on the mountain is still God in the valley. When things go wrong, He'll make them right. And the God of the good times, He's still God in the bad times. And the God of the day is still God in the night. We talk of faith when we're up on the mountain, but talk comes easy when life's at its best. It's down in the valley of trials and temptation, that's when faith is really put to the test. But the God on the mountain is still God in the valleys. when things go wrong. He'll make them right. And the God of the good times, He's still God in the bad times. And the God of the day is still God in the night. And the God of the good times, He's still God in the bad times. And the God of the day is still God in the night. Hallelujah. Aren't you glad that He's like that? The God of the day is the God of the night. The God of the mountains is the God of the valley. Well, speaking of that, would you please turn your Bible over to the book of Deuteronomy, chapter number 11. The book of Deuteronomy, chapter number 11. And I'd like to just read a passage, make a few comments on it, then make a few suggestions about it, the Lord being our helper this afternoon. Notice, if you will, and I was reading again, and this is a blessed chapter in the Word of God. Now, I know that all of them are good, but there are some of them that seem to me better than others, just to tell you the truth. As I'm reading through that, they apply, my mind just surges through them and waves around in them. Of course, that's kind of like studying a book. Whatever book we're studying is my favorite one, you know. And so every passage I get into it, it just becomes one of my favorites. And this one here is just a favorite passage. It deals with God's warnings and exhortations to the people of God to stay close to Him. And what God would do for them if they would just put forth the effort to love Him with all their heart. God says over and over again, evidently, He does want to bless His people because He doesn't want them to stray away. He said, if you'll just love me, He said, there won't be anything else that you're going to have to be concerned with. Just love me. Well, let's read the passage and you make the application to your own heart, because this is such a wonderful passage for the child of God. Therefore, thou shalt love the Lord thy God, and keep His charge, and His statutes, and His judgments, and His commandments alway. And know ye this day, for I speak not with your children, which you've not known. Now, I know this perhaps doesn't sound correct politically, all right? But young'uns don't know everything that mom and daddy knows. Did y'all know that? Young'uns is still young'uns. And I'm glad we found a little scripture for that. To hear some folks talk about their young'uns, they put them on the same level. And of course, the Bible says in the latter days, children are going to be their leaders. And we got a lot of young'uns acting like they're leaders right now. Or at least they think like they're like leaders. But he says, now I'm not talking to the kids. And I'm all for, you know, helping young'uns and evangelizing. And I know young people can get saved. I know all of that. But there are things that God has laid out for grown-ups. And here's one of them. He says, and know ye this day, for I speak not with your children, which have not known and which have not seen the chastisement of the Lord your God, His greatness, His mighty hand, His stretched out arm, and His miracles, and His acts, which He did in the midst of Egypt unto Pharaoh, the king of Egypt, and unto all his land. The young'uns might have been there, but they didn't understand what was going on.
But the grown-ups were there, and they were to understand that it was God at work in their history. And what he did unto the army of Egypt, unto their horses, and to their chariots, how that he made the water of the Red Sea to overflow them as they pursued after you, how the Lord hath destroyed them unto this day. Now the young'uns came through with mom and daddy, but mom and daddy really knew it took the hand of God to deliver them. Boy, isn't that something? Now, I'm not talking to the kids now. I'm talking to you, the adults that saw these things, that experienced these things, that witnessed these things. And what he did unto you in the wilderness until you came unto this place. And what he did unto Dathan and Abiram, the sons of Eliab, and the sons of Reuben, how the earth opened her mouth and swallowed them up, and their households and their tents and all the substance that was in their possession in the midst of all of Israel. You were right there. You saw when they began to usurp authority from Moses, and you saw how God dealt with that thing. Now again, the young'uns might have been there, but mom and daddy were the ones that ought to be getting the message. Is that right? You were there. You saw it. God is God, and in the midst of his people, he's God. But your eyes have seen it all, the great acts of the Lord, which he did. Therefore, shall ye keep all his commandments. I would say that what he has said to them would have been a pretty good incentive for them to stay close to God, wouldn't you? What God had shown them, how God had led them, how God had delivered them, how God had fed them. I would say that that was a good incentive, a good motive for just walking with the Lord and loving God. Therefore shall ye keep all the commandments which I command you this day, that ye may be strong and go in and possess the land whither ye go to possess it. And that ye may prolong your days in the land that the Lord sware unto your fathers to give unto them and to their seed, a land that flowed with milk and honey. For the land whither thou goest in to possess it is not as the land of Egypt, from whence ye came out, where thou sowest thy seed and waterst it with thy foot. Now, I read that little phrase like that. How in the world did they water it with their foot? You know what he was talking about there, don't you? Egypt was a land that was sandy. And they had no irrigation system like what God gives to Israel after a while. They had to carry the water to their crops. That's what he's talking about. You're not going to have to go out there and get you a 5-gallon Lowe's bucket and, you know, an old sheetrock bucket and pick a bucket of water up and tote it to the garden and water it. Not in the land I'm talking about. It's well-watered land. He goes on to say this, but the land whether ye go to possess it is a land of hills and valleys. Now I want you to underscore that. We'll come back to that place in a minute. It's a land of hills and valleys, and drinketh water of the rain of heaven. A land which the Lord thy God careth for. The eyes of the Lord are always upon it, from the beginning of the year even unto the end of the year. You know, that's a wonderful thing, isn't it? That God is watching over everything day in and day out, night and day, because he never sleeps. Isn't it wonderful that God would make a promise to Israel like this, that you're not going to have to take and worry about your crops? I'll make it rain. All you've got to do is stay close to me. Just keep my word. Follow my commandments. It's the way of the transgressor that's hard, not the way of the righteous. That's all God said for him to do. And it shall come to pass, if ye shall hearken diligently unto my commandments, which I command you this day, to love the Lord your God and to serve him with all your heart and with all your soul, that I will give you the rain of your land in its due season, in his due season, in the first rain and the latter rain, that thou mayest gather in thy corn and thy wine and thine oil. And I will send grass in the fields for the cattle, that they mayest eat and be full. Take heed to yourselves, that your heart be not deceived, and that ye turn aside and serve other gods and worship them. Boy, isn't it good of God to give a good warning to them after he says all that he will do for them, just to warn them, to bring it back to their mind. Now listen, don't turn aside. Don't get off track. And then the Lord's wrath be kindled against you, and he shut up the heaven, and there be no rain, and the land yield not her fruit, and lest ye perish quickly from off the good land which the Lord giveth you. You remember those bad years that Pharaoh dreamed about, where that awful blasted corn ate up the good corn. Those skinny little mangy looking cows ate up the big fat cows. God says it to Israel right here, lest ye perish quickly and the land becomes a bad land. Therefore, shall ye lay up these words in your heart and in your soul, bind them for a sign upon your hand, that they may be as frontless between your eyes. Ye shall teach them to your children, speaking of them when thou sittest in thine house, and when thou walkest by the way, when thou liest down, when thou risest up. Thou shalt write them upon the doorpost of thine house, upon thy gates, that your days may be multiplied, and the days of your children, in the land which the Lord sware unto your fathers to give them, as the days of heaven upon the earth. Boy, isn't that a phrase right there? I love the idea of having a little heaven on earth. You know, I've watched folks just walk around so sad, seemingly, and under such a dread because they're Christians and they're pushed down and pressed down and afraid to have any fun. Well, I don't want to be, like some of these people are. But I want you to know I enjoy living. Now I know, if you was to ask Sister Ann, she might consider me a stick in the mud sometime. And I'm not going to just jump up and down, and I ain't playing ball. There's some things I ain't doing. Now I have done it, but I'm going to tell you, I'd just soon you throw me as me throw that ball. Some things I'm just not, I've done outgrown them. This athletic body I've got may look like it can do all that, but it don't. It just don't, I've got that A figure now. I used to have that inverted A, but now I got that regular A figure. Stands for Alabama. But the fact is that God said, if you'll just stay close to me, if you'll love me with all your heart, if you'll serve me, I'll make your days like heaven on earth. It's a good thing to be right with God, ain't it? Praise God, it's good to be right with God, like heaven on earth. If you shall diligently keep all my commandments, which I command you to do them, to love the Lord your God, to walk in all his ways and to cleave to him. Then will the Lord drive out all these enemies or nations from you, and you shall possess greater nations and mightier than yourselves. And every place whereupon the soles of your feet shall tread shall be yours. What a promise God gives to his people. That little phrase back over there in an earlier verse here, it said in verse number 11, but the land, whether you go to possess it, is a land of hills and of valleys. I was thinking about that. You know, someone said some time ago that simplicity is truth's greatest garment. And that's so. It doesn't have to be complicated. God's truth is not complicated. We make it complicated and hard to understand. But the whole truth of this text is, if you'll love God and live right, God will bless you. And in that land, there are going to be hills and there are going to be valleys. And you need not expect it just to be smooth sailing, but you do need to expect that God is with us whether we're on the mountain or whether we're in the valley. He'll make it fit for us and us fit for it. The height of the mountain is not told to us. The depth of the valley is not told to us in these verses. But it is told us that there are hills and there are mountains, and God's in the hills and God is in the valleys, you know. And so I wanted just to say a word about that tonight, about the hills and the valleys in the Christian experience. Most all of us can say we've been on the mountain. And all of us can say we've been in the valley. And so I wanted to just offer a few thoughts tonight that maybe would help us as we're going forward in our Christian experience. Maybe they won't help us. Maybe they won't. But I'm going to offer them to you in case they do. All right? I'd like to say to you, first of all, you remember the valleys when you get on the mountain. When you get on a mountain, you remember the valleys. Don't just forget them. Can I remind you that our Lord takes us up just like he took Peter, James, and John up on the mountain. There on the mountain, oh, the sight that those boys saw, Christ transfigured. Dear friend, in those glorious times in your Christian experience, you're walking on the mountain, everything's light as air. You better remember the valley. You're not going to stay on the mountain all the time. The air's too thin up there. You're coming down. You are. Now, I'm not suggesting to you that the Christian life is like West Virginia. If you was to iron out West Virginia, it'd be as big as Texas, you know. But I am going to suggest this to you, dear friend. I'm going to suggest to you that all of us are going to walk in high ground sometime or the other. We ought not forget the valleys, though. Don't forget them. God will bring us back down after a while. Now, God is too wise to make our lives all sunshine and no shadows. If all we have is sunshine, it'll be like around here mowing the grass. Brother Bob says, all we're doing is stirring dust. Too much sunshine hardens the clay. You gotta have some showers once in a while. And dear friend, thank God he knows how to take and bring the showers into our lives. We're overshadowed by the presence of the Lord, His cloud comes over us. These days that sometimes a cloud may come over us are days of darkness. We can't see, we can't feel, we can't touch, but we trust Him during those hours. And so I want to say, when you get on the mountain, you get on the mountain, remember those valleys that you've come through, you know. Don't forget them. It may seem as if you might stay on that mountain forever, but I promise you, you won't. You're going to get to go back into the valleys after a while. And then when you get in that valley, you need to do this. You need to remember the mountaintop when you get in the valley. I mean, you know, sometimes we have the idea we've gotten so low we're never going to get back up there. And that works in our mind and it works in our heart. We don't see how it can get any worse. And we've trudged down through here in this thing and all we can see is up there. Friend, listen, you remember you were up there one time. And it may look like it's going to be a long pull to get back up there, but I say to you this, you remember that mountaintop when you get down there in the valley. I don't think we ought to invite the valleys because of things we do. Do you? You know, every now and then, I think I was talking with Brother Dwight, and I'm so guilty of this. My personality can invite a valley for my feet if I ain't careful. You know, sometimes we just invite those difficult days and hard days. Some of us is just ugly. And that leans to a valley experience and sometimes a prolonged valley experience. I don't think we need to invite those things, do you? I don't think there's no place in the Christian experience for us to be like that. I think we need, when we are in the valley, to remember if it's not of our making, then it must be of God's making. And while we're there, we're going to look towards the mountain and rejoice that we'll be back up there sooner or later. When you hit the bottom, I'm going to give you a little word of advice, all right? When finally in your experience you hit the bottom, you've held on as long as you can, let go underneath are the everlasting arms. You're not going to fall. Hallelujah to God. Now I realize that, you know, some folks have the idea that everything is just smooth sailing and you're on level ground. You're never on level ground. Never. When you're in the valley, remember the top of the mountain. When you're in the mountain, remember the valleys. The valleys are real. Sickness comes to our lives, it may look as if we have forgotten the mountain. Don't forget the mountain whenever your health fails. I mean, God's still God. And just because you can't do like you used to do, your body is racked with pain, and I'm not belittling that. Sickness is a terrible thing to go through. But don't forget the mountains that you have been on. They'll encourage your heart. When you feel lonely and loneliness invades your lives, don't forget the mountaintops that God has allowed you to walk upon. When your life seems like it's characterized by sadness, don't forget those good times you had with God. His grace was abounding everywhere, and there was blessings to the right and to the left, and you were walking with the Lord. Don't forget those times. Loneliness and sickness and sadness can cause you not to remember that there was a day when you did walk and you did run, and you did fellowship, and you did have glory in it. I was tickled this morning coming to church. Sister Joyce is back there, and Sister Joyce tickles me just to talk with her. Sister, you're just funny to me. I love you to death. I just love to hear her talking. And she just had a recent wedding. There was a wedding in her family. And that was a granddaughter. Is that right? Granddaughter got married. And they got married. They had their little reception, you know, and it was hollowed out in the middle so they could have a little bitty, you know, dance at the reception. Sister Joyce said she didn't dance much. I mean, she said she didn't dance. You better get that right, you know. But they had some dancing. And she says, was it your, it was the groom, isn't it? The groom, she says, he couldn't dance. He just couldn't. And she just sat there and laughed at him. He couldn't dance. They was trying to teach him how to, you know, do them dance. He couldn't dance. And the young sister that got married, she could dance, you know. I got tickled at him talking about that. Listen, when sickness comes and loneliness comes and heartache comes, you're down there. But remember those days when you had good things. It's good for us to do that. Remember, the mountains are still present, even if you're in the valley. And there are two mountains that make one valley. You remember, there's a lot more good things than there is bad things in the Christian experience. Could I give you something else just to kind of keep in your mind? And I realize that somebody says, oh, Brother Ralph, this ain't Bible. Well, it is Bible. I just don't know where to put my finger on it. All right? Let me give you this. When you're in the valley and you see others on the mountain, don't get mad. Don't get mad because they're enjoying themselves and enjoying life and enjoying God and having prayer answers. Don't get mad. And remember, you're not the only one in the valley. Other people are down there. And God sent you down there so that you can help them that are down there. Don't get mad at those that are still up on the mountain. I mean, dear friend, Elijah's down there and he's got his head cupped in there. And Lord, I'm the only one down here. And those Baal worshipers all around. Oh, God, everybody's forsaken me. He said, get up from there. He said, I got 7,000 over yonder that ain't bowed the knee to me. You're not the only one down there, friend. God sent you down there to help those that are down there. And if you miss that, you'll miss a lot of the joy in the mountain experience. And so while you're in the valley, remember, you know, or while you're on the mountain, remember the valley. While you're in the valley, remember the mountain. And when you're in the valley and you see others on the mountain, don't get mad at them. Just find out what God wants you to get out of that valley. You're not the only one down there. Peter said it like this, beloved, think it not strange concerning the fiery trial that is to try you, as though some strange thing happened to you. It's not a strange thing for God's people to live down there in the valley or go down into the valley. Don't get mad at folks in there. Let me give you this. When you're on the mountain, don't forget those that are down in the valley. You know, sometimes we'll parade our Christianity around and say, oh, brother, just trust the Lord. Just trust the Lord. You know. Oh, we'll be praying for you. Just trust the Lord. Have a heart that's big enough and sympathetic enough to embrace them, to love them. You know, one of these days I'm going to preach on the Eagles. I've heard preaching all my life on the Eagles, and I've tried it a time or two, but you know, my Eagles always stayed on the ground. They never did soar up in the skies. But there's a lot of things about the Eagles that are very instructive for the child of God. And one of the things about Eagles is this, is that they go through a molting period. And when they go through that molting period, their feathers fall out. And it looks like they're just mangy. Their beak gets all crusted up. And they get grounded, so to speak. They can't fly well. They're down grounded and they're hitting their head and their beak up against rocks to try to break that crust off, you know. And they get hungry because they can't fly and get their prey. You know what those other eagles do? Those other eagles will fly around. They'll get prey and they'll drop it down on those sickly eagles. Oh, y'all ain't getting this. Listen, sometimes we love to go to the Bible and get something for ourselves, but our heart's not in it. Sometimes we like to take and pray, but we can't get to seem no farther than the ceiling. Sometimes we like to talk to somebody about the Lord, but our voice is silent. We'd want to say amen, but we can't find a place. Thank God some old saint of God will come around and saddle up beside us. Say, brother, you know, I know that you might be going through a hard time, but I'm praying for you. And I want you to know I love you. Look what God showed me today, and I just thought you might be interested in this. I want to say to you this, that dear friends, when you're on the mountain, don't forget those that are down in the valley. Ask God to enlarge your heart on their behalf. And then let me give you this last little thought right here, and you can just kind of put it down somewhere in the back of your mind, maybe somewhere in your heart. When you're in the valley, don't forget to look to where there's help. Over here in the book of Psalms, listen to what it said. In Psalms 121, there in verse number 1, the psalmist said, I will lift up mine eyes unto the hills, from whence cometh my help. My help cometh from the Lord. I want you to know you're not far from having help. I don't know how deep the valley might be, how dark it might be, or how long you've been there. But I do know this. We're serving the Lord that is the God of the hills and of the valleys. And dear friend, I want to say to you, when you're in the valley, don't forget what to look for the Lord. Psalms 123, listen to what he said. Unto thee will I lift up mine eyes, for thou that dwellest in the heavens, behold, as the eyes of the servants look to the hand of their master, and as the eyes of a maiden to the hand of her mistress, so our eyes wait upon the Lord, our God, until that he have mercy upon us. I want to say, don't forget to look for help. If you're in the valley, don't forget where to look. Look up. Look up. The Lord is the Lord, both of the hills and of the valleys. And I saw the Deuteronomy chapter number 11 later on. Now, you're familiar with the book of Deuteronomy. There's four messages of Moses there, and he's preparing them to go into that land. Joshua's going to take over in a little while. And he's telling them, he's saying, now look, the terrain of this land is nothing like Egypt was. Egypt was flat and sandy, and Egypt was like that. He says, it's not anything like that. When you get over there, there's going to be some ups and there's going to be some downs. He says, but when you get up, don't forget about the downs. And when you get down, don't forget about the ups. And when you're up, don't forget about those down in the downs. And when you're down, don't forget about getting mad at those that are on top. He said, no matter where you are, especially if you get down there, don't forget to look unto the hills from whence come your help. Look to the Lord. He'll give you some help. He's the God of the hills, and he's the God of the valleys. God on the mountain. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. All right, would you stand with me?